Okay, so I guess Hindawi's institutional membership program is quite a bit different from both the BMC and PLOS memberships. We only started it about 2 years ago, so it's still a relatively new program. And basically, it is like an all-you-can-eat kind of model. So what we'll do is, in order to calculate the price of the membership, we look at all the total APCs from that institute over the past 12 months. We then apply a 10% discount to that and round down to the nearest $1,000. And then the membership will entitle any faculty member from the university to publish for free. There's no cost borne by the authors for any submission during the membership term. So if the membership term were to start today, any new submission after today for the next year would be covered, even if the manuscript is still under review when the membership ends. So we have had memberships that were not renewed, and we still will honor the waiver for any in-process articles. So it's in that sense, it's pretty straightforward. I mean, I think there's a lot of benefits to doing it this way. First, at the time of submission, authors know for sure that the money that they will not be asked any money. So it's not as though the membership will run out of money at some point before their article is accepted, and they're going to be asked for charges. So from the author's point of view, I think that's a real benefit. And on sort of all sides, on the sides of the authors, on the sides of the libraries, and on our side, there's very little administration here. Basically, once a year we have a discussion. We'll send the data back to the library explaining how the membership was used over the past year, what the status of all those manuscripts are, and what the price for the next year will be. And apart from that, they don't really have to look on a case-by-case basis at anything. But at the same time, there are some drawbacks to how this works. The first, which is something that I think BMC went through with earlier membership programs, is the cost can fluctuate wildly. I mean, in 2009, we had 117% more submissions than in 2008 across our program. So that means for some institutes, they're going to end up seeing their price double. In addition, there is, once you've made the charges free on a campus, it's quite likely that that'll encourage a lot more papers to come in. So a library might sign up this year for, I don't know, $5,000 or something. By the time next year comes around, it might be $13,000, $14,000, and it can be very difficult for them to continue the memberships. And from our perspective, it's a bit problematic if they cancel, because they were invoiced at a discount to last year's fees, and the membership covers this year's fees, so we end up sort of covering the difference. So that is a bit of an issue. The other issue is what we've sort of been talking about here. There's no way to selectively choose what gets covered. So we have had some of our members saying we would like to have a little bit more discretion over this to say authors who don't have research funding should be eligible, but authors who don't should not, or who do have research funding wouldn't be eligible for the membership. In the way that our model works, that's not really possible. And one of the real reasons is we feel it's important to be able to tell the authors at the time of submission whether or not they're going to be covered, because we don't want to have this uncertainty of them having to apply, and then if they get accepted, they go to the library and then maybe find out that they're not going to be eligible. So I think the program works really well for the authorship, but it does have these problems that it cannot be used just as a safety net. And it also has this moral hazard problem that it completely insulates the authors from the price of the journal. And we certainly feel that one of the main benefits of open access publishing models is that it will create a lot more competition than exists in the subscription world. And so that's a real problem with it. In terms of the uptake, as I said, it's only been about 2 years since we started, and we currently have about 20 members in the program, and they vary. We have very small institutes who only publish one or two articles a year, and then we have larger institutes that publish, maybe a dozen or two dozen articles a year. In terms of our revenue, I think it's somewhere between 1% and 2% of our revenue is coming through the institutional memberships. So it is still very small in terms of the total picture. And that's one of the reasons why we can sort of make this model work. If it were to take off and really become 50%, 60% of our revenue, it would be difficult during a time of growth to be charging a discount to last year's prices when you're going through sort of doubling growth year to year. So it's something we're quite conscious of, and we don't expect that the uptake is going to become so high soon that it's going to be problematic for us as a business. But it is certainly something that we would be concerned about if the uptake got higher. That's it.